Second reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a VLO tax and special source revenue credit agreement by McCombs Corporation, South Carolina, and Project Cedar.
Move to approve on second reading.
Have a motion, second. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative, and it passes. Next, we need to receive information, take desired action in reference to a resolution with respect to consent to the assignment and assumption of an interest in fee agreement from Flatwood Farms Two LLC to Flatwood Works LLC.
Move to adopt a resolution.
Take a motion, second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative, and it passes. Next, receive information, take desired action in reference to the replacement of Harper County Courthouse. Catherine, turn it over to you and Mike.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to call on Mike Thomas with Justice Planning Associates to provide an update to council on the discussion regarding the replacement of the courthouse.
Okay. For improved public safety, you can see these on the screens on the two sides, provide good public service. We wanted to maintain court consolidation, and I'll talk about that at some length. Obviously, provide a healthy and safe environment, and you had a budget that we had to meet. So we looked at a number of buildings with that in mind. We tried to have criteria that we could use, and Elizabeth, if you'd advance that slide. We knew we were going to need a big building. We were looking for something in the neighborhood of 150,000 square feet or larger. We needed a building which would let us zone things if we could. Part of the problem with your existing courthouse is that everyone mixes in the public zone. You have the public, you have prisoners, you have judges and juries, court staff, and the general public, all crammed together, frankly, into circulation zones. It's one reason we gave your building a 2 on a scale of 1 to 10. We needed to have separate entries for judges and for prisoners from the public. That was important to us. We needed big column bays. If you don't have big column bays, you're going to end up with courtrooms where you have columns in the middle of the courtroom. Now, this is sort of a column which is decorative and off to the side, but imagine putting one right in the middle where it interferes with sight lines and creates real security issues. You can't do things like that with courthouses if there's any way to avoid it. And most buildings have column bays that are quite narrow, 12 feet, 15 feet, 20 is pretty much the maximum you'll find unless you have a building like this one, which was at one time sort of a big box store. This was, I believe, a Sears building, and it has 25-foot column bays. But even that's not wide enough. So we knew we were looking at a more like a warehouse, which would have, say, 40-foot column bays. That's the preferred width of a circuit courtroom, for instance. We needed to have adequate ceiling heights. I'll explain why that's important a little later. We needed a good physical condition. Some of the buildings that we found had roof leaks, had water intrusion problems, had environmental issues on site with soil contamination. None of that obviously was going to work. I can keep going through these, but I've hit the high points. We needed parking for about 600 spaces. That's what would be required to support a modern court operation. If we split your courts up, we'd need more parking spaces than that. But 600 if we could get you all in one location. So we were looking for something along that line, and we looked at a lot of buildings. I think in total we looked at well over 100 buildings. We looked at elementary schools, we looked at office buildings, we looked at warehouses. The Toys R Us building was mentioned, although it's much too small. We went all over the county looking at buildings. We found one that worked, and in our last meeting, we talked about that, the last meeting that I attended. We talked about that building. That would have been the Flatwood 3 building, which was a large, new warehouse. New was great, because there was nothing in there we had to tear out. There was nothing in there we had to remediate. We were dealing with a brand new space that we could do anything we wanted to. We were still going to have budget issues. It was still going to be a very close thing as to whether we could meet your budget to upfit that space. But at least we had everybody in one location, we had plenty of parking, we had a big site perimeter, I could improve security outside the building, I could improve security inside the building. I could create even better public access than you have in your existing courthouse. There were pluses to that building. Unfortunately, as you know, the lease negotiations broke down and it was not possible to complete that transaction. At that point, we started to rethink the whole plan. And we started to advise the council, and we came last week to look at additional elementary schools. They were no better than previous elementary schools we've looked at in terms of really being able to make them work effectively for the courts. We looked at the Houston Elementary School. We looked at the Chapman Elementary School. It's just not in your interest to do this. If there were an emergency, if a hurricane blew your roof off, as happened down in Charleston, if a fire ravaged the building, if something happened that forced you on an emergency basis to leave your existing courthouse, we would help you do that. We would help you find other locations that would work no matter how we had to break it down. Make operational compromises, fine. Throw the rule book out, fine. Throw the checkbook out, fine. But absent that kind of real emergency that would compel you to leave the building and do it immediately, it is not in your best interest to do that. It is definitely not in your best interest even to move now to a large warehouse which would not be new, which would have issues of its own, which would require operational compromises or financial compromises. I just couldn't advise you to do it. The Flatwood 3 solution, frankly, was unexpected for us. I had been talking to your county administrator for a couple of years about the possibility of moving to transition space, and I had always consistently advised against it. It's a lot of trouble, it's very expensive, and you're going to end up worse than where you are now. Worse than where you are now. Flatwood 3 came along and I changed my mind. I thought we could make Flatwood 3 work. I thought we could make it work extremely well, and I thought perhaps it was worth the financial investment that you would put into it. As it stands, I can't support any other solutions which would require you to leave your existing building. I think you should hunker down. I think that you should do everything you can to improve the overall air quality in that building, get rid of the stale smell of the air in that building. And I think you should simply stay there for the 4 years that it'll take to design and construct a new building. So that is our best professional advice to council. We have other things. If you want to advance to the next slide, Elizabeth, we have spatial and operational implications of breaking your court down into multiple locations. We have spatial and site implications. Studied it. The council has already seen these, and rather than go through them in detail, I think I will just say, if we break your court system into pieces and move those pieces around the county, you will operate less efficiently than you do now. That's common sense. It will be less effective and less efficient than it is now where you're all in one place. It will be more expensive to operate, and it will be more expensive to upfit the space. It's doable. You could do it. The question that I would ask council is, why would you want to do that? Why would you break something that is not truly broken down? Your court system is working in your existing building. We can make it work way better in the new building. I could have even made it work better at Flatwood 3. But making it work worse does not seem like a good idea to me, and particularly not when it's going to cost money. And particularly not when it's going to slow down the time that it takes to get you into a new building. If we start now, we've only lost 3 months. We were in the process of working toward a new building in January when we took a little side turn here. But we could get back on track very quickly, and that would be my advice to council. Are there any questions that I can answer?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. At our last meeting, I entertained a motion that we take action, and we decided to delay that action. I would like to move that we continue to occupy our current courthouse until the new courthouse, as approved in the referendum, is completed and occupied on the same location.
Do we have a motion? Do we have a second?
Second.
Do we have a second? Any other discussion?
Yeah, actually,
I want to thank Mr., if I could, thank Mr.
Go ahead, Thomas.
And his comments. I didn't want to cut you short, but I wanted to get the motion on the table so at least we could discuss it. And I think what you're saying is some of the things that some of us have been experiencing in the last month or so, and I applaud you and your company for what you've done so far, and I think that this is the road that we need to take. I would make a motion at that point, so I think this is what we need to proceed.
Mr. Brand.
Mike, I know I've asked you before, a consideration like building off to the county jail, just to move to legal, what logistically would be a problem?
Well, you can't just move to court. You've got to move a lot of things with the court. You've got to move the relevant portions of the court's office there. You've got to have the solicitor going out there. A public defender has to go out there. Private attorneys have to go out there. The public has to go out there. If I wanted to do something like that, as we've discussed previously, I'd probably do it through a video system. There are plenty of jurisdictions around the United States who've done video plea. It's a lot easier to leave the prisoner where he is and leave the courts where they are and leave the public and the attorneys and the clerk and everybody else where they are and just do that by video. You could make that work, and there are a number of other things that you could make work. I just think you'd be jumping through hoops you don't need to jump through. I don't understand the reason why you would do that.
Well, if we were looking at trying to break up the court system, and if the majority of your cases in a criminal document are handled by police, well, there's no consideration for a jury, where you already, as you just stated, you already have the solicitor going to the jail now to deal with bond issues. You already have public defenders over there now, not only visiting clients, but also handling matters such as bond. And you actually have the actual individuals that will be a part of that system, meaning those who are housed at the county detention facility. I'm just trying to get an understanding of how that could not work.
Oh, it could work. I've actually experienced that in a number of jurisdictions. The vast majority of those jurisdictions are trying to figure out how to make it stop working, because they don't like the way it works. They don't like the public image of it. They don't like the idea that it's sort of one-stop shopping. We'll arrest you, we'll put you in jail, we'll try you right here at the courthouse, you'll plead guilty right here at the courthouse, and then you'll spend the rest of your time in jail again. Russia does that, and it works really well in Russia. It does not work as well.
You said they do that in York County, too.
They do a lot of things in York County that I would not recommend to you. I have worked in York County. And that is not an ideal situation by any means.
Have you ever heard the term rocket docket?
I certainly have. That's the Virginia.
York County.
Well, the real rocket docket is the Virginia Circuit Court, Federal Circuit
South
Court.
Carolina. York is moving cases by having that exact model.
But they're not doing it because of that. If you wanted to move cases faster, video would be a far faster method than that. Again, if you want to do that, do it. If you want to do that, you don't need my advice or permission to do it.
You have
to start talking. Certainly, I've looked at it all over the country.
I mean, for Spartanburg.
Why would I look at it? What is the reason for doing that? What's that got to do with transition space?
In terms of being able to move your court efficiently and potentially effectively, since that's a question, I'm obviously asking that.
This, to me, Mr. Brown, I'm being as genuine with you as I can. This is a straw man. If you want to do that, do it. It's got nothing to do with transition planning. It's got nothing to do with whether you're going to move out of the existing courthouse. You're talking about taking one judge and creating a docket over the jail. If you want to do that,
no. I simply asked it in terms of the possibility of complementing that particular opportunity with others. If you break up the court system, I mean, office space downtown, additional spaces. I see a bill that you had listed.
Let me give you an example. Let's do an example of exactly what we're talking about. And let's make it easy. Let's say that we want to move the council somewhere. We need to move the council out of this building and into temporary space. Now, we can't find a space that's quite as big as this one. So the first thing we're going to have to do, it's a narrower room, it's not as wide. You won't have exits off to the side. You're going to have to come in that front entrance, and there's a single corridor down the center of the room. We're going to have to put you closer together because it's a narrow room. So you're going to sit closer together than you are now. It's a low ceiling, so I can't elevate you in that room. I've got a column here and I've got a column over there, but I can get in between those columns if I squeeze you close enough together. Public won't be able to see you very well, but that's okay because we won't have room for much public in there anyway, and not much room for the press. We'll have to push these tables closer together, and when you have an executive session, you're going to have to walk out that public entrance right by all the public and walk back in right by all the public. So your security officer is irrelevant now because you have no security. You have no separation. Your county administrator is not going to be able to all fit in that space, so we're going to have to split them up. We can maybe get her legal department with her or her finance department. We can't get both. Human resources, building maintenance, we can't get all those in there together. Now, no one can say that that doesn't work. You can make that work. My question to you is, why on earth would you want to do that? Why would you leave a space that is working now and go to a space that won't work very well? So I think you misinterpret me if you think I've been saying you cannot make that work. I've been saying you should not do that because it won't work well. You will lose efficiency, you will lose public safety, you will lose security, you will lose convenience, you will lose effectiveness. But you could do it.
In terms of all four operations as you suggest, or some of them, meaning if you break
well, we're either going to move out of the courthouse with everybody or we're not.
Oh, I understand that, but in terms of breaking up in different locations.
Yeah, you split up the court into multiple locations, it will not work as well. That's just common sense. It will not work as well. Could you make it work? Sure. We can make anything work anywhere. And I told you in executive session, we could make anything work. It just won't work well. And I can't, in good conscience, to advise you to do things that won't work well, that'll work worse than what you have now.
Okay, Dave. I've got two questions, but I want to make a comment. It may be similar to what Michael was saying. When we first started talking in late January about possibly moving
out of the courthouse, I contacted a contractor who's, this is Spartanburg, you know, upstate contractor that's doing a lot of work here, and ask about building a facility out on California Avenue at our jail. So we would own that building rather than leasing one. This is before the Flatwood site actually came up, or came to, you know, as an opportunity. The contractor came back after a couple of weeks, said number one, it's gonna cost us around $35 million to do that. People had problems with the $13 million or $14 million. $35 was out of the budget. Plus, the site was not big enough. We couldn't build a 150,000 square foot facility. And then, you know, I was thinking we could actually own it after the 4 years and move in. So the site wasn't big enough. So we did take a hard look. It wasn't just the court. I was looking at the whole thing. The question I have, Mike, you know, my first question to you, late Friday afternoon, we received the OSHA report. What did it tell us, in your professional opinion?
What I saw was that there is no evidence of mold contamination in that building. The mold levels in that building are lower than they are outdoors. What I did see was a problem with a buildup of carbon dioxide in certain parts of that building where there isn't as much fresh air being circulated as there should be. The zoning in that building is very poor. It's an old mechanical system. It's not zoned well. So my understanding is that there are some rebalancing efforts being undertaken now, particularly in the family court effort area. And I would, this is a little bit outside my area of expertise, but if you'll allow me to make this suggestion, I would look hard at ways to bring in some additional air into that building. If you have to spend $1 million on mechanical systems for that building, we were going to spend way more than that on mechanical systems anywhere else you went. We were going to have to build mechanical systems that would handle occupancy spaces at any temporary space you moved to. And that would have been throwaway money. When you left, those mechanical systems would be of no value to you whatsoever. They would revert to the owner, who could either use them or not use them as he chose. And in most cases, if it were warehouse space, they tear them out. They wouldn't be using them at all. Spending some money on your existing building to make it a little more habitable, a little more comfortable for the next 4 years, while you're getting into your new space, makes good sense to me. The costs would be far lower than moving to transition space. And unless we had an outstanding solution like Flatwood 3, or unless you had a bona fide emergency like a hurricane blowing the roof off the building, I'd do that.
So those reports that
the air outside was actually worse than the air inside when they tested it.
For mold contamination? Absolutely. Okay. Those mold spores are everywhere, and they did not find any highly hazardous mold spores at all in the building. I think the Stocky Botches was the, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, was the one that people were most concerned about. They found no evidence of that. It was the CO2 levels in a few places.
All right. And CO2, high CO2 levels, yeah, cause what kind of problems?
Well, the air smells stale. And if there's not enough fresh air, if there's not enough oxygen, you could have headaches, you could have a sore throat, you could have some nasal congestion just from that stale air. And I've literally in my work been in, this is not an exaggeration, thousands of buildings. I can usually smell stale air when I walk into a building. There are areas of the courthouse that smell a little stale to me. It's not dangerous air, it's just not as much fresh air as you'd like to have. I don't know if that's fixable or not, but I might spend $1 million trying to fix it if I could.
All right. Last question is, of all those sites that you showed on the slide back, if you don't mind flipping back to it, all those sites you visited, Mary H. Wright, Chapman Elementary, Houston, you did Chapman and Houston last week, right?
Yes.
All these sites, if we were to break up our court, move the courthouse out, put them in various buildings, again, your contention is it's more expensive than the $15 million to do that and go to Flatwood.
Flatwood was going to cost $13 million in upfit, and it wasn't $13 million because it was Flatwood, it was $13 million because it's $13 million. The more you break it up, the more expensive it's going to be. You have to construct multiple things at multiple places, and you have to duplicate things. You have to duplicate space, you have to duplicate mechanical systems, electrical systems, servers. It's going to be more expensive if you break it up. And then it's going to be more expensive to maintain. Your energy costs will be higher at multiple locations. Your security costs will be higher. So Flatwood was $13 million to upfit it, and then there was the ongoing lease cost that was going to be about $1 million a year, give or take. So you're up around $18 million. Conservatively, anywhere else we went, you'd be well over $20 million.
Any other questions, comments?
I have one, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Witt, far.
It may be out of line. I was going to ask Ms. Blackbeard, if you would like to speak, if that was acceptable, but she is up to room.
Any other questions, comments? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes. Thank you much. Next item on the agenda, receive information, take desired action in reference to replacement of receive information, take desired action in reference to barn, wind, venues. Catherine, anything to add to this conversation from our last meeting?
So, Mr. Chairman, the staff will be ready to do a presentation at your regularly scheduled meeting on April the 16th. As an update to council, our staff has visited six of the barn wedding event venues. I think they have one more scheduled for this week. Of those event venues, we've issued 3 90-day temporary use permits, and we have one more that's pending. 2 of the venues don't have any events scheduled, so they're not interested in obtaining a temporary permit at this time. As we talked about at the last council meeting, each one of these temporary permits have some conditions. There's a certificate of insurance that the county has provided from the insurance company that insures the venue. They've had the fire chief who has jurisdiction over the area where the event venue is located. They've been on site with our team and provided conditions based on the individual site that help support any of the safety needs for the site. Those are part of the permit as well. And the permit doesn't begin until the first event happens. So if an event isn't scheduled until April, the 90 days doesn't begin until that event happens. But again, we'll have a full report for council at your April the 16th meeting.
All right. Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask a couple of questions?
Okay.
Ms. Catherine, forgot what I was going to ask, but the wedding venues, if they these temporary permits, are we able to extend those or reissue another temporary permit once the 90 days are up, or how does that work exactly?
So we're taking a look at what options would be available to council. That will be part of our April the 16th briefing for council.
And how many venues so far have kind of taken us up on the 90-day?
So we've issued, of the six sites that we visited, we've issued three temporary permits to those venues. Those are 90-day temporary permits. We have one that's pending right now. I think we're just waiting on some information. And two of the venues do not have any events scheduled right now and have not asked for the permit at this time.
Okay.
Bob, do you have a question?
Yes, sir. Ms. O'Neill. At our last meeting, we decided, you know, to postpone it and look at it. And what you're saying is we still need some more time. My concern is I'm sitting here looking at a letter that I received, and I think it was along the same line that Councilman Nutt, not Senator Dave Councilman.
Sounds pretty good, though.
Councilman Nutt was addressing. This happens to be somebody that's already got a contract that's outside the 90 days on the permit that's already been issued. So I'm not going to make a motion like we had last time, but I do want us to really consider and be prepared when we come back and at the next meeting is to address these as have contracts for 2018. That was my initial motion, was to cover that time frame. Yes, out in the future, we got to make sure we cover other areas to make sure. So I would ask that we try to get some resolution to this area, especially.
Yes, and Councilor Walker, as you and I discussed on Friday, the 90-day temporary permit is something that is contained in your ordinances today.
Right.
So it wasn't an arbitrary number that
right.
was chosen. And if, as I shared with you on Friday, if there is any way for us to extend beyond the 90 days or allow an extension to get through the current scheduled weddings or other events, we're certainly trying to make that happen.
Thank you,
Matt. Mr. Chairman, yeah, I just want to say that most of us have done a lot of work in this area about the wedding venues. And the things that, like we've said, the things that we're able to do here in the county, we are absolutely doing. We've already, I believe, John, we've sent information to the Planning Commission, and I was able to see the ordinance change on Friday that's proposed. And so we're moving along with that, and as it should be, government takes a long time to turn around because we don't want government being able to move on our private property rights in a quick manner. We want it to be slow and something that we can look at and make sure it's correct and get public scrutiny before we do anything. But in this case, we're going through that process. We're changing the parking. We're changing the paved driveways, all that kind of stuff that we can do. I know that Bob and I, and I'm sure Justin and several others have had discussions with their representatives at the State House, and some senators I've talked with as well. They are aware of the situation where the regulatory agency, LLR, who gives us direction on what we can classify and what we can't classify. They have given us direction. We are looking into what our approach is to that. Is what can we go rogue and classify it something that they say we can't classify it as? What are our options there? We're looking at all that. But our legislators are aware of the situation. They don't need council to tell them what to do or tell them that there's a problem. Certainly, it's better when it comes from the people that are affected. And I know that all the people that are affected can certainly call up their neighbor who's their representative and just tell them that this is very important and what we need to do. It's not fair that these venues, in my opinion, are religious ceremonies most of the time, are not classified in the religious category. It just doesn't make sense to me, but that's not our call. If it was our call, we'd have made it 2 or 3 months ago. So we are on your side on this. We will do anything we can, certainly as a county, but we'll lobby for you. We'll do whatever needs to be done. But please make sure you contact your senators and your representatives. Let them know what's going on and how they can fix it. If they need to talk to any of us, tell them they can call us and we'll discuss it in whatever forum they need. So that's, and we're gonna, in our next meeting, we're going to try to do whatever council can do and get this thing moving. But it's the way government is sometimes.
Good comments. Any other? Need a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.